I'd like to call to order the Board of Education meeting for Monday, January 14th. If everyone would stand to recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, let the record show we have all members present except for Tracy Rankin. And Jamie will have to step out early. She's got a child's birthday tonight, so.
Yes, 18.
We have, we need the adoption of the agenda, including the supplemental personnel report. And you'll see that we added for the consent agenda an item for the grant from the Kansas Masonic Literacy Center for Central Elementary.
And I've asked to add an executive session for the potential acquisition of real property.
Yes.
Make a motion for approval.
I'll second.
Motion by Tammy, second by Jeff. All in favor? 6-0. And I was able to look over the bills, and everything seemed to be in order, so I will make a motion to approve those bills.
I'll second.
Motion by Lisa, second by Jamie. All in favor? 6-0. Okay, we have next up a special presentation by the Tournament of Champions Committee.
Good evening. We are the senior chairman for the 2019 Tournament of Champions Committee. Over the next several minutes, we will be informing you of the upcoming tournament to be held on January 17th, 18th, and 19th at United Wireless Arena. We would like to thank you for all of your help in making this tournament a success. This year marks the 76th annual Tournament of Champions. This is the longest running tournament west of the Mississippi. We would now like to show you the championship night intro video from last year. Again, this year's tournament will be held on January 17th, 18th, and 19th at United Wireless Arena. TOC is a class taken sophomore through senior year. Some of the committee's responsibilities include the Tournament of Champions, working the scoreboard for volleyball games, helping with WAC track, and helping with office work for athletic events. This year's committee includes juniors Abigail Harding, daughter of Derek and Jan Harding, Elise Helfrich, daughter of William and Mary Beth Helfrich. Sophomores Arissa Darville, daughter of Tila Darville. And Sitlali Real, daughter of Hiroberto and Araceli Real. My name is Madeline Kelsher, and I am a senior at Dodge City High School. I am the daughter of David and Diana Kelsher. My school activities include the Tournament of Champions Committee, volleyball, softball, National Honor Society, Student Athletic Trainer, Drill Team Captain, and the 6A representative for the Cassia Student Advisory Team. My future plans are to attend Wichita State University and major in athletic training. I later plan to attend physical therapy school. The schedule of events for this year's tournament includes: on Thursday, first round of games will begin at 2 p.m. The all-tournament academic team and current TOC recognition will take place before the final game. Dodge City will play in the 7 p.m. game on Thursday night. Friday, tournament teams will read to elementary students in the morning. The cheer attraction will take place before the final game around 7 or 7:30 p.m. Dodge City will play in either the 6 or 7:30 p.m. game on Thursday night. Saturday, the SCA event will begin at 8:30 a.m. with special guest speaker Kylan Moore. This year marks the 65th annual free throw contest, which will take place between the second and third games on Saturday. The DCHS band will perform before the final game, and the all-tournament awards will be presented after. Teams coming to this year's tournament are Dodge City, 6A. It is their 76th appearance, and they have 14 titles. Bishop Carroll, 5A. It is their third appearance. Derby, 6A. It is their 18th appearance, and they have one title. Hutchinson, 6A. It is their 23rd appearance, and they have two titles. Junction City, 5A. It is their third appearance. Newton, 5A. It is their 23rd appearance, and they have three titles. Shawnee Mission South, 6A. It is their 12th appearance, and they have one title. In Wichita North, 6A. It is their fourth appearance. Here is the 2019 Tournament of Champions bracket. Dodge City will play at 7 p.m. on Thursday night against Hutchinson. They will play at either 6 or 7:30 on Friday night.
I am Aria Nedler. I'm a senior at Dodge City High School, and I'm the daughter of Kelly and Tammy Nedler. My activities include Tournament of Champions Committee, Drill Team, Choir, National Honor Society, Student Council, FCA, and debate. My future plans are to attend Kansas State University and major in musical theater and political science. The talent coming to the 2019 tournament are Ty Berry from Newton. He's currently being prospected by Kansas State University, Iowa, Mizzou, OSU, and Nebraska. Noah Sowers, Dodge City. He was last year's all-tournament player and is currently averaging 21.3 points per game. Bishop Carroll, they're the defending 5A state champions. And Shawnee Mission South, who are currently ranked number 7 in class 6A. Some of the all-time greats include Ron Baker, who played for Wichita State and is currently playing with the Washington Wizards. Bubba Starling, who plays for the Kansas City Royals organization. Lon Kruger, who is the OU head men's basketball coach. Glenn Piper, who is a Dodge City High School All-American and played for the University of Colorado. LJ Goolsby, who played for Wichita State, Ole Miss, and is a Dodge City High School All-American. Perry Ellis, who played for KU and is currently playing professionally in Europe for a German team. And B.H. Bourne, who played for KU and his retired jersey now hangs in Allen Fieldhouse. As a senior TOC girl, our responsibilities include contacting basketball teams, cheer coaches, Man Fridays, and officials. We also scheduled the halftime entertainment for the tournament. And this year's halftime entertainment includes the Dodge City High School Drill Team, the Dodge City High School Cheer Team, CMS Drill Team, DCMS Drill Team, and other community gymnastics and dance teams. We also scheduled the National Anthem Singers, and this year's National Anthem Singers are Andrea Varela, Lorenz Looney, Lizette Moreno, myself, and the Dodge City High School Madrigals. On championship night of the tournament, our 220-member Pride of Southwest Kansas will perform a short show and the national anthem before the final game. They also provide a pep band for all 12 of the tournament's games.
My name is Katherine Greenleaf, and I'm a senior at Dodge City High School. I am the daughter of Mike Greenleaf and Stephanie Lanning. My school activities include Tournament of Champions Committee, Fellowship of Christian Athletes, National Honor Society, Student Council, Advanced Teacher Cadet, and TALC President. My future plans are to attend Kansas State University and major in elementary education. The annual cheer attraction show will take place before the final game on Friday night. This attraction combines several of the tournament squads as they perform to a mix of popular songs. The Dodge City High School Drill Team will perform during the halftime of the final game every evening. This also includes a special surprise routine during the halftime game of the championship game on Saturday night. The first FCA breakfast was held in 1970. Since 1981, there has been an FCA event held annually. This year's guest speaker is Kylan Moore. Oh, didn't mean to do that, sorry.
I heard a quote one day.
Thank you.
I was about to be a street sweeper, then you sweep streets like Michelangelo painted, sweep streets like Da Vinci wrote, sweep streets so well that when you die, that all the hosts of heaven and all the hosts of earth may look at your grave and say, there lived a street sweeper who did his job well. So I started applying that approach to my football training. I started applying that approach to rehabilitation for my back and for my body. I started applying that approach to academics. So I convinced myself, I'm a little delusional and I'm a daydreamer, just like my mom is. She taught me to be like that. So I told myself, I said, you know what? I think I'm smart enough to be a PhD from Harvard. And I just, one day I just kind of got that in my mind randomly. And I wrote it down on a piece of paper. And then I put it on top of the ceiling of my room. So I ended up somehow in my spam folder. It was an opportunity to go to Princeton for a pre-graduate school program to prep you for being a PhD and all these things. And it's an Ivy League school. So I said, maybe that's a little sign. So I applied to it. I don't know, but by the grace of God, I got into the program. I did the Fulbright Commission Summer Institute program, and I studied at the University of Bristol, and that was like an amazing experience. All these experiences are like, I was a finalist for the Truman Scholarship, and I flew to, I'm from California, but I've never been to Northern California, so I flew to San Francisco for the interviews and stuff, and just being around such a group of elite young minds, and seeing myself in the same room, a young African-American man with dreadlocks in his hair from the inner city, and I'm qualified and chosen to be in the same room as all these elite individuals, it makes me wonder, who am I really? And stuff, so I kind of just started to like change my mindset towards myself and stuff, and trying to seek opportunities that are greater than anything that I could have imagined. And eventually, I hope that's going to help other people do the same.
The 2020 tournament teams will be Dodge City, Bishop Miege, Leavenworth, Mays, Manhattan, Shawnee Heights, Wichita East, and Wichita Heights. Western Plains Medical Complex has been the official partner of the Tournament of Champions since 2012. Our other sponsors are Dodge City Community College, United Wireless, Forget Me Not Farms, Kiwanis Club, Lions Club, Rotary Club, and J&J Powerline. Once again, the tournament will be held on January 17th, 18th, and 19th. On Thursday, games begin at 2 p.m. On Friday, games begin at 1 p.m., and on Saturday, games begin at 12 p.m. All 12 games will be streamed live at dchssports.com with audio provided by Z98. Tickets are available online at Ticketmaster.com or at the United Wireless Arena box office. Thank you for having us. Are there any questions?
My favorite weekend of the year.
You ladies always do a great job. Great job.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mass exodus. Okay, next up we have Stucco Reports. We have Alejandro Rangel from Dodge City High School.
Okay. Hello, Board and Dr. Dirksen. Our canned food drive last month was very successful. With help from administrators, we collected 2 truckloads of non-perishable goods with an additional $100 in donations from the students. We'll be doing the drawings for prizes soon, which, as I mentioned last time, include gift cards and parking spots around the school. As the TOC girls mentioned, TOC is this week, and the TOC girls have done an outstanding job of organizing all of that. Tickets are $20 for students, which includes access to all 12 games and a t-shirt. Along with that, if students sign up with a Red Demon app, they can be entered into a chance to win prizes through that. SAD, our Students Against Destructive Decisions Club, began selling carnations this week, which will be delivered on Valentine's Day. Each flower is $1 and goes to a great cause supporting the club and other community projects that they do. It's a busy week for athletics, and the girls' basketball team is playing a home game against Great Bend at the Fieldhouse tomorrow night. The boys' swim and wrestling teams are on the road this week. The bowling team will be competing at Spare Time Bowl tomorrow beginning at 3. And last but not least, Stuco is prepping for Winter Royalty, and our senior members will be assisting others in preparing their applications and handling voting for everyone in the school. Do you have any questions or anything you'd like for me to clear up? All right. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. I think it's Grace Pelton with Comanche that has our report. Is that right?
Yep.
Okay. So it is Andrea for CMS. Andrea. Okay.
Good evening. I'm sorry I wasn't here last month. I was playing basketball against DCMS. We have been very busy at Comanche Middle School since the last Board of Education meeting. Our jazz band performed at the high school. Even though our jazz band is small, they performed well. Our sixth grade orchestra performed in December as well. Our sixth grade orchestra has 38 members, and they sound really good. Our choir also performed in December. Our choir continues to grow. It is getting big enough that the stage will barely hold them. They also did a great job. On the last day before break, we had our activity day. We had stations set up throughout the school and rotated between the stations. There was dodgeball, basketball, bingo, a movie, board games, and open gym. It was a fun day for all the students. We ended the day with the CMS band marching through the halls playing Christmas songs. Basketball had their first game last Thursday. Our boys easily beat Great Bend. So far, we are undefeated. The drill team and cheerleaders performed during the first game, and both did a great job. Scholars Bowl also had their first meet last Thursday. The eighth grade placed fourth in the tournament. The 6th and 7th grade had their awards assemblies last week, and the 8th grade will have their awards assembly this week. If you would like to come, it is on Friday at 7:45 a.m. We are planning to sell Rio roses for Valentine's Day. They will be $1 and will be delivered to the classrooms. The money that we will raise will go to Stuco funding for the upcoming dance. The dance will be right before spring break. We have just started to talk about the 8th grade send-off to the high school. We might do a carnival or a movie. We're just planning. Thank you.
Thanks, Andrea.
Thank you.
Good job.
Now we're ready for Grace from Dodge City Middle School.
Good evening. Though we have only been back from winter break for just a week, Dodge City Middle School has been very busy since the last time I presented, and I'm here to fill you in on just some of the exciting activities. The DCMS PTO hosted its annual bingo night on December 18, 2018. The event included a silent auction, live auction, and two raffles. It was a great success, with 23 local businesses donating items, an estimated 100 people in attendance. The DCMS PTO is excited to continue with this event next year. Winter activities, including boys basketball, Scholars Bowl, and drill team, are in full swing. The varsity Scholars Bowl team took fourth place out of 9 teams, while junior varsity Scholars Bowl took second place out of 9 teams at their first competition. The 7th and 8th grade boys basketball teams lost their opening games against Garden City's Kenneth Henderson and look to continue to grow and improve as they prepare for the remainder of the season. The DCMS drill team is looking forward to performing on Thursday, January 17th at the 76th annual Dodge City High School Tournament of Champions basketball tournament. The drill team will then be preparing for their spring tour to some of the local elementary schools. The DCMS National Junior Honor Society is preparing for their next class leadership event being held at Cimarron Middle School on Tuesday, January 15th. The DCMS Information Technology Program has been practicing their computer programming skills by using Minecraft and the Hour of Code website to create a variety of virtual reality worlds. The DCMS Student Council is preparing for their next school dance. The Student Council will be hosting their second school dance of the year on Friday, February 15th. The DCMS is excited to be the host site for the Southwest Kansas Music Educators Association for Elementary and Middle School Honor Choir Festival. On Saturday, January 19th, approximately 300 students were selected by a tryout process representing elementary and middle schools from across Southwest Kansas. We will gather to practice a number of songs and we then perform a special concert in the afternoon. I hope you would consider joining us at 2:00 for the concert this coming Saturday. Thank you for the opportunity to present. Do you have any questions?
Thank you, Grace.
Good job.
Thank you.
All right, recognition of visitors. Persons may present ideas or concerns regarding USD 443 schools. No action will be taken by the board at this meeting. Personalities and behavior of employees are not to be presented during this period, but are to be reported to the employee's immediate supervisor. The president shall determine the amount of time to be spent for citizen participation. And Lindy DeRee would like to present to the board.
Okay, I was really expecting Aunt Ethel to do this, so I'm a little bit nervous. It's been a while since I've spoken in front of a crowd. I'm probably going to end up reading most of this, and if I lose my place, I promise I'll try to find it and hurry on. At this meeting, we plan to request that the board declare that school will not be in session in USD 443 public schools in Dodge City on the day of state and federal elections. Further, we respectfully ask that you offer the use of any and all of USD 443 schools to the county clerk of Ford County for the purpose of holding elections using the buildings needed for polling places. The rationale and the supportive materials follow. A blueprint for making a lemonade stand. The first rule of lemonades is if you get a lemon, you make lemonade. During the midterm election of 2018, it seemed as though Dot City sorta got a lemon, publicity-wise. There was a lot of criticism of us from coast to coast, from north to south, concerning our provisions for voting. Regardless of anyone's position on the problem, we all knew we looked like we had a lemon. Well, we just finished a building program here that meant every school building in the district is in wonderful condition, handicap accessible, safe, entrance limited, and up to date. Not only that, they are located throughout the city, so that they should be easily available to all segments of the populations. It has been said that all politics is local. Well, how local can you get? The school seemed the obvious way to be local and accessible. If you were to choose to make this a teacher in-service day, it would not need to be in any way disruptive of the education process. There should be ample parking available, with teachers' cars not needing to be parked there all day. If having the day off meant paras and other staff would be available, notice the possible pool of election workers available. Perhaps some of them might even be bilingual, just what we need. The high school might even want to involve their old enough to vote and almost old enough to vote students in some projects. The student council could probably get involved. All kinds of opportunities for school projects for all ages abound. What a learning opportunity it could be. And we could boast a little to other areas of Kansas about how we handled elections in our schools. And we could contact the New York Times and the LA Times and the broadcast networks, telling them what we were doing to solve our old problems. If the city chose, they could even ask the CVB or whatever agency is appropriate to advertise a little about how we usually drink sarsaparilla down at the Long Branch, but sometimes, shucks, we just have to have a glass of lemonade. Don't you think it has possibilities? We could even call it the rest of Dodge City's story. P.S. Problem solved. If you do choose to grant this request, the next step, of course, would be to submit this proposal and offer to the Ford County Clerk, since the decision is hers as to where to hold the election. It is hoped this might make her choices and the election much easier. Thank you for your time. I am representing a group called Community Action Project Committee, and right now those members are Ethel Peterson, Glenda Woods, Greta Clark, and me, Lindy DeRee. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lindy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would be glad to share a little bit of more information, and I actually uncovered some today as well. I met with these ladies and had a great conversation. And as you know, we've talked about this before, and I'm very supportive of such an idea. I'd like the board clerk to make sure that our school attorney gets a copy of that. And I didn't make enough copies. I wasn't expecting 40. I made 20 copies. So anyway, as I told Ethel in our conversation, there are two conditions that are out of my control. And that is, number one, we have a two-year calendar that we work, and we're already working on it. And we've had no foresight of the need for this, because number two, which is the most important point, is it's not the school's decision, it is the county clerk's decision that controls it all. And I've made it known, I've been very verbal, we've talked about it here in open meeting, recordings on TV, that I'd be willing to do that. And then I remembered and called KASB today, but back when they changed the voting calendar for local elections, there was talk that some schools were going to have a problem with the local elections, and the legislature actually created legislation that required exactly what was just asked for. And this is a copy of the statute that was passed in 2015 that says all unified school districts shall make suitable school buildings available for polling places at the request of the county election officer for the county in which all or a portion of the school district is located. The county election officer shall give notice on or before January 1. That didn't happen this year. There's been no notice to the superintendent by January 1. So that prevails having to worry about it at this point. However, if that ever happens, then we will, and as I've said before, we'll be very supportive. So I just thought that was very interesting that really ties in exactly what we want to do. So I think we're gradually getting there. It's just not as fast as Ethel wants it to be, I do believe. So, but I thought that really tied in, and I want you to have a copy of this too so that you can share that with your group, okay? Yep, absolutely. And thank you for your time. Appreciate you coming and presenting.
Thank you.
Lindy, would you give Ethel our best, please?
Oh, I will.
Okay. Okay. All right. We are ready then for our consent agenda. That includes the approval of personnel, including the supplemental personnel report, approval of minutes for December 10th, 2018 Board of Education meeting, approval of Kansas Early Head Start Child Care Partnership grant application for Bright Beginnings, and the Kansas Early Head Start Home Visitation Grant application for Bright Beginnings. Also, as noted earlier, the approval of the Kansas Masonic Literacy Center Grant Award for Central Elementary, the approval of the Rotarian membership, and approval of the Student Response Manual, second reading.
I make a motion for approval for the consent agenda.
Okay.
I'll second it.
Motion by Tammy, second by Jeff. All in favor? 6-0. Okay, we're ready for new business, curriculum, and instruction. First off, the update on instructional coaches.
Well,
Well, good evening. And I believe this is Board Appreciation Month, if I'm correct. And so I just wanted to take the opportunity to thank the board. And there's no better way to do it than to have students present. And then you're going to hear here in a second, get a presentation from our staff. So thank you for what you do as public servants for our students and our staff and our community. What we have in front of you today, I wanted an opportunity to present to you an update on where we are with our instructional coaches. And so, not to spend a lot of time on it, but you guys are aware of the audit that was conducted last spring. And in that audit, it gave some direction and some, direction to look at our instructional coaches and how that helps to support the vision of professional development and ultimately student outcomes within our district. And so we started with that audit, and since I started here in July, really in August, when the coaches reported, had the opportunity to visit with the instructional coaches as well as the administrators throughout the district to kind of get a lay of the land as far as perceptions about instructional coaches in two categories, what they believed the instructional coaches' roles were and also what they were not. And I said that was very fundamental for us to start with a basis of kind of a knowledge point as far as what we perceive and what we believe that the coaches should do in the district. From that work, what we were able to do, which you'll be presented with, and it is in your board packet, you're going to see what we believe are the essential job functions of our coaches, as well as the process by which they go to support our teachers. This all is a piece of our fundamental shift in professional development. And the best way I could give you as an example is in our classrooms, we're not necessarily just measuring our students based on seat time that they show up. We actually are expecting that our students can show and demonstrate the content that we expect them to learn in each class at each grade level. Well, our PD is very similar to that. As we start to look at a lot of different ways that we restructure our professional development to get it into application. It's one thing to have all of our staff come to a professional development meeting and provide that valuable information, but how then do we ensure that's being taken and applied? And more importantly, how it's impacting our student learning in the classroom. So we've really invested in what research is showing is that to do that, we need to provide processes or individuals like these instructional coaches to be able to help our teachers one-on-one or in small groups or large groups take that content knowledge and actually apply it. And so that's really the essence as far as the philosophy behind our coaches. So I know I didn't tell them that I was going to do this, but I do. I'm very proud of their work and what they do, and I think it's important for you to see a face and a name in what building they report to. And then I do have three coaches that will do the presentation. So if I can start with Bridget, and we'll just kind of go across. If you'd stand up, say your name, what building you're in.
I'm Bridget, and I'm the first grade as
Brandon Miller, and I'm at Sunnyside Elementary and Willow Road Elementary.
Okay, where are we?
I'm Kylie Myers, I'm the fifth grade coach on the floor. Whitney Waters, I'm third grade at Lynn Elementary.
Robert Rams, I'm at Ranger Middle School.
Angie Schaefer, special education preschool through 12.
I'm Bonnie Austin, I'm a high school instructional coach mainly working with mathematics.
And I'm Lori Amaro, and I'm instructional coach for fourth grade, and I am at Central Elementary. So what I'm going to go over with you will kind of just hit on what the instructional coaching job function is, and you have that there in your packet. I'm just going to go through and give some examples of how we're doing that currently. So instructional coaching cycles include partnering with teachers and administration. And as an example, cohort one, teachers are working and collaborating with their instructional coaches to model and integrate research-based vocabulary strategies into their student needs and into their teaching. Teachers have also shown their appreciation for the opportunities that the grant has provided to efficiently co-plan lessons with plenty of time to work with the coaches while having a substitute provided. The partnership between teachers and coaches allows for the teacher to see the coach as equal as themselves, and they'll be teaching in the same setting with the same students as well as the teacher. As a coach, reflecting on my model lesson has been extremely helpful to me as a professional, not only to self-reflect, but also get another person's feedback. Instructional coaches impact student learning, and doing this, we're available for multiple meetings, such as PLCs, which are professional learning communities, the building leadership teams, and student improvement intervention teams. So, for example, during SIT meetings, coaches collaborate with the team by providing ideas and strategies to address student needs to move them towards success. Coaches also provide professional learning opportunities for paraprofessionals in buildings. And myself, I've worked with not only 443 paras, but also with the 613 paras as well. And some things that we help them with are teaching them how to do certain things like fluently navigate the frontline system, train them to the skills needed to work with small intervention groups within their buildings, and even train them to work in after-school tutoring sessions. Also, coaches serve teachers within their buildings, which is a great example of research-based professional learning that is job-embedded. They deliver and utilize professional learning opportunities in this way, and they also support district initiatives and learning that is presented at grade level meetings and staff developments. It also provides for the time for follow-up, like Dr. Springsteen said, that we need to ensure that teachers are getting. Then instructional coaches will also make sure that their work is student-centered, and I think most of my examples so far have been mostly student-centered, but I'd like to add in there that coaches also work with teachers aside the grant work, using student data to identify areas of need for their classes, such as guided reading instruction, classroom management, math instruction, and progress monitoring for various subjects. And here, before I close, I just wanted to give you a couple of stories of feedback from teachers. So Michaela Bacon from Lynn Elementary, she's a first-year teacher, and she said, both grade level and building coaches have helped with ELL students. They help me find ways to implement visuals and present the material to the students so they are able to learn it. They've also helped in finding motivating things for individual students to work towards instead of having to work for the whole class reward system. Emily Gonzalez, first year teacher at Central Elementary, said, as a new teacher, I've had many questions. My coaches helped me with a variety of things, including curriculum, Skyward, grading, and has given me tips and ideas that have in turn bettered my classroom management and instruction. Having someone available in my building that can help me through questions that arise and everything I have to learn as a new teacher has been critical to my career. Priscilla Morton, 8-year teacher at Sunnyside, said, instructional coaching cycles have allowed me to begin the process of promoting transfer in my classroom and helped me in my areas of struggle and my students' areas of struggle. It also has helped me to reach higher levels of learning for my students. Through research, discussion, and planning, we have been able to establish a process that best fits the needs of my students in this area. The reflection piece of this process has strengthened my ability to modify lessons in order to get the best learning out of my students. Trisha Blanco, K through 5 special education teacher, 5th year at Sunnyside, said, my experience in having a building coach and a coach to help with 613 specific topics has been wonderful. They have both been there to support me whenever I need them to be there. Moments of collaboration with my building coach this year has been especially nice because I have an extra person that is taught and specialized in special education right at my fingertips. He is always willing to help me out when I need it and make sure that I am involved in what goes on at the school and district level. I am glad that I have access to both coaches because they both have contributed to expanding my knowledge in different areas. So coaches are still able to maintain their passion for education and teaching students while being able to step outside of the focus in order to oversee the process of teaching to assist in positive adjustments. We also get the privilege to not only work with one class per year, but many, which has been an enjoyable experience that has allowed us to establish new relationships with a greater amount of students.
Good evening. I'm Amy Fleener. I am the instructional coach at Dodge City Middle School, primarily in math. And I want to also thank you for the opportunity to be here and share what we are so passionate about. All of those things that Lori talked about, we call the coaching cycle. And so tonight, I'm just going to give you a layman's view of the coaching cycle. You have it in your board packet, and you can read that at commercials of the championships game this weekend or whatever. But we are going to just give you a layman's view. There are seven steps in the coaching cycle, and every one of those steps, as Lori said, is steeped in the fact that we are a unilateral partner with the teachers in our building and in the district. And it starts with enrollment. And when we go to enroll a teacher, what we're really doing is just asking them to partner with us in a journey to look at their classroom, look at their kids, and see how we can move them forward in the educational process. The teachers in the LEANC grant, we joke that enrollment is kind of forced enrollment, but the rest of them have an option. Once we've enrolled a student, then we would identify a need. The identification process is totally on the teacher's voice, the teacher's choice, based on their data, based on their decisions in the classroom. They pick the goal that they want to work on. We come alongside and we support that. We find resources, we find research for what they think they need to move forward in their classroom. So once we've enrolled them, we've identified them, then we clarify what's going on in the classroom. This really is where the bulk of our work comes in. We do a lot of behind the scenes research, data digging, talking to other coaches. Clarification comes with just a myriad of questions on our part. Having that teacher really investigate within themselves where they want to go and not any opinion of ours. Again, that partnership. Together, after we've asked questions, gotten answers, gotten feedback, we decide where we're going next. So we've enrolled, we've identified, we've clarified, and then we as coaches get to have some fun. After we've clarified, we do what we call as a model lesson. That teacher and the coach will sit down, we'll plan a lesson together, and then the coach will get up and model it for them. And that teacher is not really watching us. They're watching student interaction and student feedback with whatever strategy, whatever resource we've picked to help them move forward in the classroom. We'll sit down and analyze that together. Hopefully that's taped. Some teachers don't like to be taped. But hopefully that's taped. We'll analyze it, what went well, what didn't go well, and then we'll have some more fun. We'll plan another lesson. The teacher will teach that one. I'll sit back and watch, observe students. We'll sit down and analyze what went well, what was successful, what do we need to tweak. We'll explore all of that together, and then we come to the final stage of refinement. Where are we? Did that go well? Are you ready to move on? Do we need to back up, do another coaching cycle? And it's just a perpetual relationship between the coach and the teacher. One of the things that I love about the coaching cycle is it gives me time. Coaching cycles aren't quick. I mean, it's a process, and it gives me time to know the teacher, their personality in the classroom, how they interact with their students, what their weaknesses are. And as you build that relationship, it's very much the teacher's voice and the teacher's choice. But as you build that relationship, they start asking for your feedback. What are you seeing? You know, how can we move students forward? So seven steps in the coaching cycle. My friend Amy Herder is going to take it from here.
I'm Amy Herder, and I'm an instructional coach at the high school, and I have an ELA focus, English Language Arts focus. As both of the ladies shared, the coaching cycle is a process. And we joke about forced enrollment with teachers that are in cohort one of the link grant, but we choose to say it's an arranged marriage. That just seems more romantic. But we get the opportunity to work with those teachers at a very deep level. And our instructional practices and our instructional understanding, we have an opportunity to share and guide with them. However, we do that through asking questions and giving feedback. One of the analogies that really spoke to me when we started exploring Jim Knight's instructional coaching process was the football coach and the quarterback. So you have an image of Don Shula and Dan Marino, and Dan Marino is doing the talking, and he's telling Don Shula what he sees on the field. Then you have another image of Tony Dungy and Peyton Manning, and Tony Dungy is telling Peyton Manning what he sees in the field. And I feel like that's exactly what we do as instructional coaches. We have the advantage of getting to see the balcony view, as we call it, in a classroom. So when a teacher is teaching, they don't necessarily see every student's response to every instructional strategy they use in the classroom. But as a coach, I can see from a different vantage point what's working, or when the teacher said this, how the student's mood changed, or how they responded to that, or things that the coach or the teacher doesn't always get to see. So we encourage the teachers to videotape their lessons, and then we can sit down and go over them together. We're gradually getting more teachers on board with that. It's very intimidating, and I will say it can be very intimidating, but once they go through that process, then they understand how important it is. At the high school level, I have 23 teachers in cohort one, and I also coach other teachers at the high school, not just cohort one with the link grant. And so I've had to group my teachers in small groups instead of doing one-on-one coaching cycles. And some of them are like, you're not gonna videotape me, we're gonna go watch each other teach. That has worked. I had one group and they were like, you know, I just really don't have time to leave my classroom and watch somebody else teach, let's just videotape ourselves. So that worked great. So one of the success stories, I had a group of four teachers, very veteran teachers, and I'm thinking, okay, so I'm not sure what I can bring to the table that they don't already do well, but they are arranged in this marriage with me, and we're going to go through this coaching cycle. And at the end of the first cycle, they all learned so much from it, but from each other, not as much from me. And that was profound, too, because I don't have to be the expert. I just get to be their partner and get to help them along the way. And so they chose to enroll in another cycle. So it's really awesome to watch them share their videos with each other and learn from each other. And then I had another group where I had a teacher who was like fed up with me. She had had it. She just looks at me and says, Amy, just tell me what you want me to do and I'll do it. I'm like, I want you to do this and this and this. Fine, just come in tomorrow. So our group went in and watched her teach the next day, and she did an amazing job. I mean, just did an amazing job with her vocabulary instruction. And I was like, seriously, I knew you'd do that. Well, what, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking, what is your problem? So I just was like, oh, okay, good. Whew. One for me. Well, a week later, she stopped me in the hall as I was working on my way to work with another teacher. And she said, I get it. I know why the Link Grant wants us to do this vocabulary instruction. And she's a very veteran teacher. And she was like, my kids have a much deeper understanding of the novel that we're reading because of the vocabulary instruction. And she's super excited to do it again. She's ready to videotape her lesson. And I'm just like, that's what it's all about. Now, I'm not saying that I'm not going to have difficult conversations or that any of us aren't going to have moments where we're like, oh my gosh. But it's so rewarding to watch the students learning move forward. Because we're not here to critique the teacher or evaluate the teacher. We're here to support them in whatever we can do to get their kids to learn. So those are my thoughts. So do you have any questions for us that we can clarify for you?
I did, and you partially answered it. How much, it didn't sound like you have much input in the evaluation of the teacher.
None, zero. Don't want to either, because that eliminates the trust factor.
I agree.
The teacher needs to be able to come to the instructional coaches, close the door if they need to, and say, I bombed this. I did a horrible job. What can I do better? That's intimidating to say that to your evaluator. And I truly believe, I've been in this district, this is my ninth year, I truly believe there's not an administrator in the district that wouldn't welcome that conversation and wouldn't be encouraging and supportive. But as a teacher or a new teacher, you don't necessarily want to tell your boss what your failures are. You want to tell somebody who will help you through that process and not judge you for that. And that's really a huge part of our job, is to not judge and not assume. It's to ask questions, find answers, get clarity, and help them move forward.
Then how much interaction would you have with administrators?
I personally have a lot of interaction with the administrators, but not necessarily regarding specific teachers. That we try to keep that as separate as possible, because like I said, that's where the trust, where we build trust with teachers, is knowing that our conversations are confidential.
Right. That makes sense, and I understand that.
Interactions would be more about these are building goals. As a coach, how can you support us reaching building goals versus individual conversations? Would you?
Right. And I've had administrators come and ask me, okay, I have a student or I have a teacher who's struggling with this. What are some things you might suggest? And I certainly am open to helping the administrator explore some things that they could use with that teacher. Or I'm also very receptive, and I think all of us are, to if an administrator says to a teacher, you know, I think Mrs. Herter could really help you with classroom management. If you want to reach out to her, I'm sure she'd be willing to help you. And then it's up to the teacher to seek us out.
Okay. I just want to make sure that coaches don't become an entity unto themselves. You see what I'm saying? That we are, and I think Tammy answered that with the fact that you know, if the administrators and the coaches are talking about the instructional goals of the building, of the district.
The instructional coaches are involved in the professional learning communities of each building. So if there's a goal within a building for professional development, the coaches are very instrumental in helping that become accountable and moving that goal forward. It's just we do it in a different way than the evaluator does.
Right. And I'll be perfectly honest with you. When I first got on the board, I got a lot of chatter among the district that the coaches are just an entity under their own, and they're not a part. I mean, and I haven't heard that in years. I mean, years. So I applaud the job that everybody's doing. But that always concerns me in any organization, that we're all, a part of the same movement.
Any of the coaches want to address that question any differently than what? Do you have any other questions for us?
Yeah, so the instructional coaches serve as a support service to our instructors through professional development and things of that nature. I'm just curious, do you guys get opportunities for continuing education yourself?
We do. We absolutely do. So every Friday or every other Friday, we have our professional learning community. So we all get together as coaches and meet with Dr. Springsteen and kind of problem solve and try to figure out better ways we can do what we do. We also all went through the Jim Knight training. Jim Knight's through the University of Kansas and has developed this instructional coaching cycle that we're using, and we received intense week-long training, and it was amazing. So yeah, we are always looking to
excellent learn. Good. I just have one more question, and I Forgive me for the question. I'm sure this was answered. I just
need
clarification. I hadn't given it much thought through the years, so forgive me. But I hadn't thought about it until everybody was giving their building assignment. But that's just a building assignment. If you're the fourth grade instructional coach, you're not just working with Central. You're also working with instructors from Beeson and Northwest within that same grade level.
What we've kind of determined as of late, because in the past it was a little bit different, but for example, the fourth grade instructional coach becomes kind of an expert on the fourth grade content.
Okay, yeah.
Now, they're housed out of one building, and so they coach those teachers. If a fourth grade teacher at another building has a question about fourth grade curriculum, we encourage them first to go to their instructional coach within their building. And if the person within their building can't answer that question, then that instructional coach contacts the fourth grade person. And between the two of them, they kind of decide, okay, what's our best avenue to help answer this question and help support this teacher?
Okay, thank you.
Excellent. I have to say, I think this is one of the best programs we have, and it keeps our teachers, we have such top-notch teachers that this is a great program, and it really does help new teachers, medium teachers, old teachers. It just helps teachers.
I can say from my perspective, we have a very good group of coaches, and we support each other, and we get along well, and collegiality is really, really strong. And so it's fun to be a part of a group that you respect and admire. So it's fun.
That's why we have quality teachers.
We have a very concentrated effort, and Dr. Springsteen has brought it to the core that it is, and that we wanted the board to be on top of all of this. That's why this presentation was.
And we did miss a few people that didn't stand because they think they're not coaches. But Kelly Clark is our link grant coordinator and professional development person. And then Pam Setzkorn is our elementary literacy coach, which she does coach. And then Lynn Nolte, who is the middle school literacy coach. And I do the literacy coach at the high school along with my other coaching. So
I appreciate that because they are coaches and we appreciate them. So,
just last thing in closing, I want to thank all of the coaches, but also the Board of Education for supporting this resource. This is about reflective practice. I mean, it's about getting our teachers to feel comfortable and safe to be able to reflect in their practice, because that truly is the most impactful professional development we can do. And so we're slowly, conversation, one relationship at a time, changing that culture. So that's part of what we do, whether it's the one-on-one, small group, or large group. Our coaches by no means are going to be the panacea. They're the catalyst to this cultural shift. And that's really where we're moving it, because we envision, as we move forward with the strategy that we have in place, is that this becomes part of how we operate each and every day as far as teachers, through our professional learning communities, through the conversations with their building leadership teams and their administrators. One thing I do want to stress over and over is we have hit it very hard. It was a request of the administrators, is we do not want coaches anywhere involved in evaluation. We want them to help people walk through their own self-evaluation. They're also here to help our principals. I mean, I've said this to the board before, and I know I've said it to our principals many times. Our principals are key to the success of any initiative and the sustainability of what we do in our buildings. And so they need to know what's happening at a functional level. So our coaches do meet on a regular basis with our principals so that they can go into PLCs or go into the professional learning communities or the building leadership teams to have a knowledge base of what the teachers are doing. They don't have to be in the deep depths like our coaches. That's why we have those resources. But they need to be able to help our principals as well navigate this and be leaders in the building. So I appreciate the opportunity for this presentation. And you guys are dismissed.
Thank you all for being here.
Yeah, it's great. And get that focus and all on one program is the key. Because we were going in
different directions. So. Mr. Turner?
As you know, we have a partnership that we work with Juvenile Services in Ford County for our Juvenile Services Reporting Center, Project Divert, and a new IDP program, which helps kids get back on their feet when they've had some issues. Basically, what I'm asking tonight, we put together an MOU with the help of Clayton, and I appreciate it, because he actually did probably 99.9% of it, to actually formalize this partnership between our organizations. So I'm asking you to approve it tonight.
Make a motion for approval.
Second.
Motion by Ryan, second by Tammy. All in favor? 6-0.
Thank you, and thank you guys for your service.
Thanks, Matt.
Thanks, Matt.
Oh, you're thin. All right. Well, I'm back. I wasn't too long ago. Well, you have in your board packet beginning on page 125. We wanted the opportunity to give the board an update on the initiatives. And as you listen to these, they're very specific on how they're interwoven and interconnected. So the first thing I want to update the board on is the District Strategic Action Plan. We have our third and final community stakeholder meeting tomorrow night. You will see kind of the ongoing timeline that I've presented to the board in the past, both in this session but also weekly notes. And so you'll see tomorrow is that third meeting. The objective of tomorrow is we've been able to look at the data through the survey as well as other data points that we've collected throughout the district. And we are developing two goals per four focus areas. So we have the face of Dodge City, financial, academic, climate, and employee. So we've, each one of our focus area chairs has been able to work with the committee, and the committee has put together, here is what we believe our data is telling us. So when we walk away tomorrow, we're gonna have two goals per area. The next step will be to develop actionable steps or objectives in each one of those. That's the what, you know, or not the what, but that's the how, where the goal is the what is important under finance and academic, climate, employee, and then we'll develop the actionable steps. Once it's done tomorrow, we'll take it back to staff and put the final touches to it. So in other words, what is our baseline data? What are we going to use for our growth targets each year as we look at measuring this? And then ultimately what we're doing is presenting it to the Board of Education. And I think what's been brought up before, and it's important to stress, is that this is a living document. It should be a blueprint that guides what is the most important initiatives that we believe is going to move the needle in Dodge City. That doesn't mean there's not a lot of other things going on, but this is what's going to be linked across what we do in the district for all four of those areas, for finance, academic, employee, and climate. And so it's been a very valuable experience, and as we reported to you guys before, to have over 60 members come, that'd be community members as well as our staff, to these meetings and participate, volunteering on their time, I think is a pretty good testament to commitment in our district. So I wanted you guys to be aware of it. Tomorrow is our meeting, and I know several of you serve on this committee, and I appreciate that. Any questions over the strategic action plan before I move to the next topic? Okay. The DC Link Literacy Grant update. One of the things I didn't state when the coaches were here is on the 30th of this month, we were asked by KSDE to host a webinar, largely with our work with the Link grant on our coaching model. We've had state representatives here that have been part of our meetings to like the gym night training. And so they're seeing us as a potential best practice. And so there's gonna be a webinar that we host. So that all came from our literacy grant. If you see on beginning on page 127 is our quarterly evaluation plan. And why you have this is you could see the five areas by which this grant is focusing on, and then how we're going to be able to measure it, what are our outcomes and our time periods. And so without going through each one of them, you'll see that it covers the areas of family engagement, our preschool four-year-old. It talks about best practice in the third area that we're measuring. The fourth area is student outcome. That's where we're gonna say, okay, we're doing all this stuff. How are student scores, whether it be local or state assessment scores, how are we moving the needle there to show that they can demonstrate what we expect them to at their grade level? And then the fifth area is focusing particularly on our ELL population. So I know you're aware of the grant and the pieces of it, but this is what we reported to the state. We received word back that they've accepted this. And so we're in the process right now of our second semester of our cohort one. That's the first group. We divided our staff district-wide into three groups for manageability and the ability to go deep. We're starting to plan next year's cohort two, which also cohort one, which would be their second year of ongoing professional development. We're also looking at budget. So as we look at budget changes for next year, where do we see our professional development? Where do we see our support potentially with additional coaches? That's all going to be part of this grant budget document that we're developing over the next few months, which we'll obviously bring to the board. Any questions over the LINK grant and where we are thus far? Okay, no?
Dr. Springs, when you develop your personal, your professional development budget, develop a dream budget. I mean, develop a budget that's the best. Mm-hmm. I mean, the very best we can possibly do, and we'll talk about money later. I'm dead serious. I mean, and I'm just one person, but I want to know what would be, if you could do it really, really the best, mm-hmm. what would you do?
Okay. Well, we have some of those things in motion. There's several pieces. I appreciate that. And we definitely will look at where we are and where we need to be and have a specific strategic plan to get there.
Yeah.
But as I mentioned before, and as we've talked as administrators, it's shifting that culture to where it's a participatory, ongoing learning
right.
culture. So I appreciate that, and that's definitely something that we're working on. I know Bill's looking at me like, uh-uh.
We'll take care of Bill.
Okay. All right. Sorry, Bill. MTSS update. On page 130 in your packet, you have the agenda for the upcoming meeting, and it's in February. So this would be our next multiple-tiered system of support. This is where the technical assistance team from KSD is coming in to assist with us. I do want to highlight a couple things in here, area 4 and 5, where we have 4, which is PLC structures. We are really embedding, we've started the work on what a professional learning community looks like. In other words, how do you structure norms and guidelines when we do get together as professionals, and how are we utilizing data to drive our decisions, and how do we maximize our resources, which are time, people, and money. And so we're going to continue that work to put unified structures district-wide for our PLCs, not just for our teachers, but across all different areas. You heard the coaches talk about their PLC that we do every Friday or every other Friday. We believe that's important because it's the collaborative, it's the collective knowledge, I think, is what these types of activities allow us to maximize. Item 5 there is the universal screener. So what we did a while back is we did an audit of all the initiatives that are in the district. And I believe I shared this. There was over 180 plus self-reported initiatives, which would be either screeners or programs or whatever our staff self-reported. That's a lot. So what we're doing now is we're starting to clean up and say, what should be unified pre-K-12? And we're starting with assessment screeners for ELA and math, so it'd be language, arts, and math, and saying, what do we use right now to assess where our students' present level of performance is and readiness level? And we need that tool to be reliable and valid, and that we can apply district-wide. So with the data that comes in, that we know what it means. And so what we're trying to do is to take the variety of what we're using and to consolidate into research-based and consistent practices district-wide. Because if we know how to measure, we can also at the same time add in what we're measuring, and that's the ELA adoption, which I'll go over here in a second. But our tiered intervention system of support, if you remember, is a 3-year partnership with the Technical Assistance Support Network from KSDE. They've been nothing but wonderful. I mean, they're a very knowledgeable base that comes down. They have lots of guidance, and it's research-based, but they also sit down with us and customize. And so I can tell you I've been very happy with their support. Our MTSS team from a district level is really that group that's going to morph into kind of the district leadership team to help us vet all of these processes and obviously embed consistency district-wide. So the curriculum review material adoption update, you don't have anything in your packet. There was referenced on item 1 of the MTSS meeting that's in your packet. I want you to be aware that on January 31st is our first English language arts work group. And so I've been collecting names from our principals to represent our district pre-K through 12 to be part of this subcommittee that will help us go through and identify our English language arts, not only our alignment to state standards, but what assessments are we going to use, but then ultimately the final piece will be selection of materials. And PD is embedded in what we do in an ongoing professional development plan.
MTSS staff will come in. I've asked them to come in and help be provide technical assistance in this process. They do not and will not recommend. So if we get to a point where we're looking at materials, they're not going to make recommendations, but they will provide a structure. So they're going to help our team looking at research behind English language arts, or in our case, literacy. So I'm also visiting with our consultants that we're using with LINK to help us with this process as well. They're here. It's part of our LINK process. We're doing a lot of that work already. Now let's move that into making sure we're aligned with the Kansas standards, but then at the end, we can also look at materials and then ongoing professional development. So on the 31st is our first meeting with this work group. We're going to also meet on the 26th of February, and then our third meeting scheduled is March 21st. I don't have anything past that until I can get the work group. Plus, we're going to be really pretty heavy into testing window. I wanted to wait until we get those first three to then set the next meetings. This will set as a template as far as what we do with the next adoption cycle. I also have had music teachers reach out to me, and we're going to be running a parallel curriculum review and material adoption process for music K-12. I've contacted a professor from K-State that's going to come down and help lead this, and we're setting that date in April, and more information will come out. So we'll use that as a model for our elective exploratory classes for standard alignment, assessment development, and then material selection. Any questions? It's quite a bit in a short time. I would offer this. At any time, any of you want to come in and sit down and go through any of this, by all means, give me a call or talk to Dr. Dirksen, and I'd be happy to set that up with him.
Thank you for the information.
Thank you.
Oh, you're good.
Get a couple.
I wanted to just give you a really brief update on KISA, and we will be presenting more information formally there, but we're kind of hot and heavy in the middle of things, and so tonight you'll just get a little brief update. We have been meeting as a district leadership team throughout the school year, managing the goals that we established last year. And just as a quick reminder, we chose the relationship goal focused on students. With USD 443, we'll foster student relationships with peers, teachers, families, culture, and community to build student self-efficacy with a focus on cultural competency as measured through district data. And then the responsive culture with leadership. We will develop, communicate, and implement a comprehensive district-wide strategic plan for all stakeholders that aligns with local and state board goals. And so as Scott presented, you know where we're at with our strategic planning, and we'll follow up more on that next week. So that's really addressing that goal. The exciting thing, and the reason, of course, our district, our teachers chose the strategic planning piece, is we needed guidance and vision and focus so that we really can nail down and make an impact with our students. And so this is really helping with that. With our relationship goal, we've got multiple layers that are helping to address this. And so with some of our cultural awareness pieces, that has been written into our DC Link grant, and they talked a little bit about that, really helping our teachers to understand the students that they have and where they're coming from. We also, through both KISA and DC Link, are working on kind of goal, a way to reach out to our families better instead of just having a meeting and saying, oh, come, and then we'll tell you about stuff. Really trying to address who our families are, where they receive their information, how they receive their information, and then authentic ways to engage that. And Mr. Montford is leading that up for us. And again, that's going to really address both the KISA and the DC Link pieces. In the handouts, it just kind of shows you some of our foundational structures. And you guys, we shared this last year, and I know you've seen this before, and you will continue to see this. And this is one of the graphics that the state uses really regularly. And so, of course, with any accreditation structure, they want to make sure that we're meeting our compliance areas. And so that is something that we look at and we review regularly each year. And then you move into the foundational structures. And one of the foundational structures that we identified as a need was the MTSS and our tiered system of support throughout the district so that we had a systemic piece, which, of course, Dr. Springsteen shared a little bit about what we're doing through that process. And so that's just an example of how the KISA process identified an area and then the follow through with that. And then, of course, our two goal areas. And with that, then, the goal areas that we're focusing on, of course, are relationships and responsive culture. But with our DC Link focus, too, that really brings in that rigor. And so we're really kind of hitting all of those areas by being very strategic with what we're focusing on and making sure that as we move forward on one area, the impact goes out there. And then, of course, in the results area, that is published and accessible through the district report card. I attended a KISA meeting today, and there was a lot of conversation about how published information is always on the delay. So you have your current this year information that you're working with, but what's published is last year's and some of those little process. But we're still going to be looking at our results and making decisions on the progress that we're making, but then also adjustments that need to be made to make sure that our results are showing what our kids are doing and making sure that they're achieving. So any questions on the KISA process?
Okay.
So thanks, Tammy.
Thank you.
Got a little big stuff on the agenda and the guide, but I want to talk a little bit about school safety and a couple of things we're doing. ALICE training is what we've adopted this year. All secondary schools have been trained in ALICE training. Elementary schools are going to go ahead and get scheduled this spring. So that is an intruder response service training. So that'll be done this spring. The second one, it's in your books, it's not up here, but it's a Google sheet we put together, and we have to do 16 crisis drills each year, which could be fire, tornado, lock in, lock down, whatever it may be. We put a Google form for each building, and what that allows them to do is put notes in there that they can look at, share with other people, see what works, see what didn't work each time they do a drill. So it should be in your book. I think it's right after the KISA stuff. Any questions on any of that?
Is, like, I saw a couple of button issues, intercom issues. Is that, I was looking for, maybe I saw maintenance in here. Is it, whose responsibility is to make sure that's
properly
working?
Well, they'll turn that into maintenance.
Oh, okay.
Taken care of. But by having this stuff, it allows for little notes so after the drill they can keep track of it, or little things that they knew worked or didn't work. So next time they do a tornado drill, for example, they can look back at their notes. We have a standard form the state requires, but it's very general information of time, pole station, stuff like that. But we wanted also, on the Google Sheets that we have shared with the staff, everybody's is available to everybody. So if you're a principal at the high school, you could look at the middle school. So if you want to see some of the drills they've been doing or see some of the notes that they've had, just to kind of share information. So, Jeff, you're thinking back there.
Never know what, though. And this may be off the subject, but I know at Dodge City Middle School, there was some dead spots as far as the walkie-talkies and stuff like that.
Well, and that's what we're working on. Fred, you want to comment on that? That's basically what we're working on with the county, Ford County Communications, and yep. Overall is clear.
And we're putting together a bid, and actually Bill and I met Sunday and talked about some important issues, and the communication aspect has to be answered. And when we come together for capital outlay, that's one of the predominant items that we're going to try to accomplish. So. What I really asked, and I think they did a great job of it, is we've not had a board meeting for 5 weeks, and there's a lot going on in this mm-hmm. district.
Yeah.
And what we've tried to do is make sure that it's all connected, that it's all relevant, and that it all ties together. And thanks to good leadership from the people that have presented, why we are staying on focus and staying on point with that. But it's important that the board understands that these things are happening all the time. I mean, there's a lot going on, and it's all for the benefit of the students of our district together. And the one key that I heard several times tonight is district-wide, mm-hmm. and we're doing these projects district-wide, and that's the whole goal that we have in mind, is for Dodge City Schools to be the best they can be. Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of pieces of that communication. There's some dead spots here and there, plus also increasing our communication within the district, plus outside the district to first responders. Mm-hmm. So it's all tied together.
Matt, I would never want to even allude to the fact that these drills are not important, because they are.
Yep.
But I think we have to be very clear on how much time out of the classroom this takes from.
Yeah, but they are required by the state.
They are required.
And they have to be done.
Can we add time to our?
Well, this is part of the world we live in today.
I know.
And it's what we have to do.
That's a lot of time.
Well, and they're always changing. These 16 came out, what, late July?
Yep.
Early, I mean, so we had to adapt quick to what we normally do. And I know there's already talk about possibly shifting some more.
And this ties in nicely with what you've already approved for the Director of Safety and Security, and to have that leadership and to make sure that we have that. Interesting, another thing that we didn't know until over Christmas break, but the State Department has now created a Division of Safety and Security. And so we're kind of on the leading edge of that, and I think that speaks well for Dodge City again. So.
Very much so.
Any other questions?
Thanks.
Thanks, Matt.
I like this chart, though. That's
thanks,
nice.
Matt.
Now, are we ready for Dr. Vinton?
Yes.
See if anybody else approaches. I wanted to give you, first of all, I wanted to greet the board, President Kelly and Dr. Dirksen. I wanted to give you an update on the ESL incentive program as to where we are with enrollment into classes and those that are becoming endorsed and those that are working toward or on the plan. Of course, the ESL endorsement incentive program consists of all these things that are listed there. That is the support that we provide for the teachers, and it's quite a list. In May of 18, we went ahead and signed a MOA, or a Memorandum of Agreement, and that is the one that we are still under as we continue to work with Fort Hays. Now, this memorandum does not preclude or exclude anybody from taking classes from any other granting university. They can continue to work with a Newman, K-State, if they should ever teach classes here. Now, one of the things that occurred is that I received some information that changed the numbers on this, and I received it very late, and to be very honest, I forgot to bring a copy of that here tonight. It's upstairs. I know where it's at. I can put my hands on it in the dark, and I just forgot. It got away from me. So these are the numbers, but as you can see, we have increased the number of teachers that are on a plan. We went from 24, we are up to 64 individuals. We dropped some certified, yes, that is true. But I think that in every respect, we have increased. And that is a tribute to those administrators that are involved in recruiting and asking our teachers to come on a plan. And we are getting there. It's been kind of tough, but we're getting there. It is showing an improvement. And I just wanted to show you all that because, as I say, we are moving in a positive direction. Any questions concerning this? No?
That's good.
Okay. Very good. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Benton.
Thank you, Dr. Benton.
Thank you, Herb.
All right. Carrie Baker.
Good evening.
No.
Whoops. I'm tearing up things here. A special thank you to the Board of Education for your service, to our district and to our community. We do thank you for that. And as you leave tonight, take a couple of extra cookies to celebrate. That will be good. And Dr. Dirksen, good evening. Also a special thank you to Pamela Preston. We've been working on the calendar committee. Her calendar that she put together was chosen as one of the top four to be voted on. Hey. And we'll have those results for you at the next board meeting so that we can go ahead and approve the calendar for 2021. And that will be before February 1st, which is mandated by our negotiated agreement. In November, I shared that we sent a couple of ornaments to the Capitol to decorate the tree. We received a thank you from Governor Jeff Collier, and I've passed that thank you on to the two teachers that provided those ornaments so that they could share those with the teachers, and I thought that was a nice touch. Also, Dr. Dirks and I have been talking about the retirement banquet. We want to elevate that and really celebrate the service and dedication of our teachers. We'll bring you more details on that, but we are planning to have that retirement celebration in a facility in our community. So you'll be getting more details, but we're looking to elevate that a little bit. Also, you'll note in your packet that there is a request for payment for an alumni website. This is for a standalone site. Now that we have an alumni director, we have visions for growth and growing our donations that we receive from alumni and also from sponsorships. And I just had another $450 one the other day, so we are seeing that happen. And we've just deemed that it's really good to have that website. We're going ahead with forming a 501c3, and when that takes place, we'll come to you for your approval, and at that point, then the alumni will operate on their own outside of USD 443. So it's just one more step in that process, and we would ask that those funds come from the alumni line item that we have with our funds. The site build is quoted at $1,495, a 12-month hosting fee of $480, for a total amount of $1,975.
So that $400-some would be an annual expense.
It will be an annual expense. And that is pretty, that's pretty comparable for hosting a website on an annual basis. It's actually, the site build is very inexpensive, but Mike Nelson has provided the quote, and he does a very good job with that.
He does.
Okay. So is the 480 then, that's cost that's an, to the district or back to the alumni?
We'll pay for it this year.
Yeah, and then after the 12.
Right. And that will be
not that it was a huge deal. I was just, I wanted to ask. Thank you.
Their responsibility moving forward.
Make a motion. We approve the 1975.
Second.
Motion by Jeff. Yeah.
You're done. Sorry.
Second by Ryan. All in favor? 5-0.
Thank you.
Thanks, Carrie. And thank you for the goodies.
I thought I cut you off. I thought you were adding more to it.
Yeah. All right. Human Resources, Dr. Nance.
Good evening, Madam President, Board Members, Dr. Dirksen. This evening I have two proposals to bring to you. The first one is to help us recruit more substitute teachers in our district. I think the principals can attest to the fact that it's very difficult to find substitute teachers, and when we've done an informal survey, we find that we're slipping behind a little bit in our daily rate, and that's not helping us any. So in the past, we have paid substitute teachers that are teaching for the same absent teacher for 1 to 10 days, $100 a day. And we're seeing that our competitors are paying anywhere from 100 to 110, 115, 120. We're hearing a little bit of that. We pay 11 days to 40 days, we pay that at $150 a day. And we feel like that's pretty competitive and stable. And then for those assignments that are 41 days or more, we pay $203.89. And that's based on the special salary that is negotiated each year with our DCNEA and just divided out by the number of hours in a contract. So that's how that number, it looks a little off, but that's where it comes from. So what we think we would like to do is just increase that tier one, $100 per day, to $125 per day. And we think that the other two tiers, tier two and three, can remain the same. So my request tonight is that you consider raising the tier one substitute teacher pay from $100 a day to $125.
I know it's been quite some time since there was an increase. Mm-hmm. So I think it's time that we do that.
I make a motion for approval.
I'll second it.
I have a motion by Tammy and a second by Pamela. All in favor? 5-0.
I just got a couple questions. Sure. Just out of curiosity, when we're unable to find a substitute in a given building or whatever might happen, who covers that class? How does that?
Principals.
Anybody, just kind of however you can make it work?
Well, and we, right. It's a struggle. And we have some paras that have substitute license. So if you're lucky enough to have one of those in your building and you can't find a sub that day, you can take that para and put them over there. Not ideal for sure, because that means that you're robbing one classroom of some instructional assistance by doing that. Mm-hmm. But it is one thing we can do. And not too long ago, you approved a proposal to help our classified staff get those 60 hours that it takes to qualify to have a substitute license. I mean, that's kind of a big deal. You have to have 60 college credit hours to get a substitute license. And that right there is a pretty big restriction.
Dr. Nance, on the help that we're, the assistance, the tuition assistance, mm-hmm. that for the ESOL, that is 30 hours?
No, the ESOL endorsement is 15.
15, so that.
Yes.
But paras would be eligible for that assistance? Or
is no, that? In order to get the ESOL endorsement on your license, you have to be a certified teacher already with your teaching license and your bachelor's degree. But what you approved not too long ago was to pay a tuition, partial tuition reimbursement for classified staff such as paras.
That's what I was
to go ahead about. And get those first 60 college credit hours yeah. mm-hmm. that it takes to even get a substitute license. Yeah. And so we're hoping that will help us recruit some additional substitutes as well. But I think the pay is right now a barrier. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Very good.
Okay, so the second proposal that I brought forward tonight is a proposal to adjust the current classified salary schedule, and I've given you a copy of the current schedule and a copy of the proposed schedule. And what you'll see is that we are trying to put in place a classified salary schedule that rewards financially our classified staff that stay with us extended periods of time. So column A on that proposed schedule is for really new employees, relatively new to the district. And then when they hit that five-year mark, and we'll review that every July 1st, we'll look at that at the beginning of the fiscal year. And those that have hit the five-year mark will move over to column B. And likewise, those at 10 will move to C and so on and so forth. And the concept behind it is that when you've worked here 10, 15 years, you should probably be making a little bit more than someone who's a new hire. Mm-hmm. Because we hope that experience is valuable and worth something, and we believe that it is. So that's the concept behind putting this new classified schedule together. As with just about everything I come and ask you for, it costs money. So I've included those figures for you as well. One point that I wanted to make, and I had a conversation with a person that's been a classified employee in this district for over 30 years today. We do have a small group of people, I'm going to guess it to be about 25 to 28 employees that have been in our district a long time, maybe 20 years or more, that won't fit on this chart. We're going to have to grandfather them in, because if we put them on the proposed chart, they would actually make a little bit less, and we certainly don't want to hurt anyone. Right. So as we look at that, and I'm working on it right now, I'm going through every classified employee individually, looking at them at their start date, what they're making right now, what will they make on the new chart, to make sure that when we place them for the February payroll, that we get it right. Mm-hmm. And so there are a handful that aren't going to really see any reward out of this classified schedule. So what I would like to do, although because I'm not complete with that process yet, I would like to, at some point, have a discussion with Dr. Dirksen and with the administrative cabinet on what we can do individually for the ones that have been here 30 years and aren't seeing any reward out of this particular program. And like I said, I'm thinking it will be 25 to 28 people that we'll have to look at out of 700. I think that's a pretty good scenario for moving that many people into one uniform chart.
Yeah.
What kinds of questions do you have for me about this proposal?
I think it's a good proposal.
I'll move for approval.
Okay.
Awesome. I think it gives good structure. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. A motion by Ryan and a second by Pamela, since she raised her hand faster than I did. All in favor? 5-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Next up, business services.
Good evening. This evening, we bring Pat Reese to do the presentation of the audit and also the engagement letter. So, Pat, if you care to come up and kind of go through this.
We really need to put him at the first.
I know.
Pat, before you get started, I got a question, and this is, comes from a bad experience, but are your credentials in place, in order with the state of Kansas? Okay, that's all I want to know.
Now that's a good question.
He's got PTSD.
After what we've been through, that's a good question.
I ask every audit I go through, PTSD. Every committee, everything.
A little PTSD going on.
I didn't bring them with me, but...
No, I take you at your word for it, because if you lied to us, I got you.
Yeah, exactly. No, I am a certified public accountant, duly licensed in the state of Kansas.
Thank you.
I'm good to go. I'm not sure if you're looking at this online or what, but there was a governance letter. It's a loose letter if you've got the packets, mm-hmm. or if you've got the actual board deal. It's a three-page letter. It's basically the same as it was last year. Professional standards require to go over a few things. The first thing... the account qualitative aspects of the accounting practice. We look at your accounting policies, which are listed in note A to the financial statements, and there were no real changes in those from the prior year, and no change in how they were applied in the prior year, or in the current year. We noted no transactions entered into without a lack of authoritative guidance and consensus, and everything was recorded in the proper period. Accounting estimates, your biggest accounting estimates, of course, are your purchase orders or your accounts payable and encumbrances, and we evaluated those and didn't find any issues. We'll look at capital projects in Note D and long-term debt in Note E when we get back to those. No difficulties encountered in performing our audit. We did make a couple of journal entries. One of them, the big one, is for medical claims payable, which is a reoccurring entry, because trying to estimate that at June 30 is difficult. So we usually just make that one for the district. No disagreements with management as far as accounting, financial accounting reporting or auditing matters. No consultations with other independent accountants. We did have two small findings. And what Dr. Nance just talked about, you have 700 employees. We did find one certified contract that wasn't signed, so that's a pretty good percentage. We did note that here. And then we did find something in when we were doing our single audit that's a deficiency in internal control and dealing with the food service approval of bills. But that's been... We talked to Kathy about that with Bill and Molly, and should be corrected already. So no real issue there either. So any questions on the governance letter? Okay, and I'm going to go faster than I did last year because I see glazed eyes after a little while, and I know I'm boring. So on page one is our independent auditor's report. Management is responsible for the preparation and fair presentation of the financial statement, and our responsibility is to express an opinion on that financial statement. And to do that, we gather audit evidence. In gathering our audit evidence, we do look at internal controls. We don't give you an opinion on internal controls, but we do evaluate them to help guide how we should go about our audit. But again, we don't express an opinion on that. And we do believe that we did obtain enough audit evidence to express our opinion. Top of page two, because you adopt a gap waiver every July, you do not use generally accepted accounting principles. You use the state's regulatory basis of accounting. So we give you an adverse opinion on U.S. GAAP, but with the regulatory basis of accounting that you do use, we give you an unmodified, unqualified opinion, which is the clean opinion, which is the one you look for. So supplementary information, everything behind the notes in this report is supplementary information, and we evaluate that in relation to the financial statement as a whole, and we give you an in relation to opinion, and in relation to the financial statement that we give you an unmodified opinion on the supplementary information. So any questions on any of that? Nope. Okay. I told Page four starts your financial statement, and basically this is a snapshot of each of the funds for the district. For the federal awards, we do kind of combine. There's like Title I will have two or three different funds, but we combine those for the report. But you can see you start out with the general funds. Those are the big ones, and then on down are the special purpose funds, and they just give you a snapshot of each one of them. If you go to the page five, you can see the totals for the district. You started out the year with about $35.5 million in unencumbered cash. You had receipts of $136 million, expenditures of $135 million. You ended the year with just over $38.6 million in unencumbered cash. So a little better shape than where you started, kind of building up that capital outlay fund to for your new project with the admin building. So of that $135 million of expenditures, $30 million of it, or $31 million of it, is transfers between funds. That are, the general fund is required to receive a lot of your money, the special ed money, and then all of the district money, and that gets transferred out to the special purpose fund. So to eliminate that, you take that out. So that still leaves you at about $105 million worth of expenditures that y'all are in charge of. So that's it's a big number, but it's a big district. So you guys are you know, that's why we always try to express, you know, you look at, you guys each month, you look at the expenditures. One of you divides up and looks at the expenditures. That's a good internal control to make sure, you know, if something pops out, gets a red flag, then you can discuss it with the business office and figure out whether or not that's a legitimate expenditure. So that's a good internal control that you all have. So any questions on your financial statement? Nope. Okay. Note A, starting on page six, the summary of significant accounting policies. Like I said, not much of that has changed since last year, so I'm just going to flip over that one. So we'll go to compliance with Kansas statutes on page nine. You do have some, the federal aid funds mainly are, you'll have a credit balance. Basically, you'll have spent more than you were received in that fund. But with the federal money, it's all on a reimbursement basis. You're kind of required to do that. So you have to spend the money before you can call it down. So you'll end up with negative expenditures or negative unencumbered cash at the end of the year, but you are allowed to finance that with other money and while you're waiting on your reimbursement. So that's why you always look like you have, you know, if you look at your schedule of federal awards, at the end of the year, you're in the hole about $1 million in your federal money, but you basically drew that down in July, so you're not really in the hole. So deposits and investments, basically the big thing there is all of the deposits were legally secured at the end of the year. All of your investments were rated where they were supposed to be, so no problems there. Capital projects, you see, and this year I wanted to leave on some of the completed the projects as they're going, so you can kind of see, you know, your bond issue was fair size, and you're looking at $99 million in projects over the last couple of years, and you're $90 million spent, so, you know, you're about 90% of the way done. So, but as that goes, you have projects every year, and as those come off, you'll see. So, but you can kind of see how the bond projects are going. So you're gaining on those.
Administration building down, is that the old? Is
that's
that
just the architect's fees. That was the only thing that was approved of at that time. So, yeah. Okay. Long-term debt, you made your payment on time. Everything's good. You can see the big bond issue runs out till 2036. So you can kind of see the first 5 years and then five-year increments to 2036. How much is due on those. Operating leases, you have some operating leases. That's what's the yearly schedule shows you what's due on the current ones as of June 30. Interfund transfers, like I said, the general fund and the LOB fund, supplemental general fund, they're the ones who get to receive the money, and then they have to transfer it to the other funds to be used. So other long-term obligations from operations, go over your compensated absence policy. You're very well aware of that. Note I on page 13 is CAPERS. That's a whole lot of words about your pension plan that you know about, so I'll skip over that. Risk management, you have your partially self-funded health insurance plan. You can kind of see how that's going. What it caught, the claims and changes and estimates, that's the what went into the fund. Claim payments, you can see that. And then you've got your stop-loss reimbursements because you reinsure for anything over, I believe it's $50,000 in claims. So, and then contingencies, there's always contingencies. And then no subsequent events. So any questions on any of that? Okay. If you go to page 15, the summary of expenditures actual and budget, basically the far right-hand column, the variance column, there are no brackets around any of those numbers, so no unfavorable variances, no budget violations, which is what you want. So, and then page 16 starts the individual funds, and I'm happy to go over them with you, but basically, you just get the money in, you spend it. It's, I can go over them a little bit more. It's
the way it works.
About right. Yeah, I mean,
it's the way it works.
It's just the way it works, yeah. Like the general fund, for instance, you can see the state aid. You get all your money from state aid or mineral production tax in that fund. All the, but see, it's called state aid, but the 20 mils that we all pay on our property taxes is included in state aid. So it looks higher, but a lot of that is taxes. If I had to guess, $3 to $4 million of that is actually property taxes and not state aid that was sent to the state and then sent back to you. So, and then you get some state aid in the LOB fund. But I'm going to skip ahead, get rid of all those funds, and go back to the single audit portion because I think that's something that you'll want to look at. Oh, just I did want to the district activity funds on page 39, we did have a little bit of an issue with those last year. That's been cleared up. Becky and Bill have worked on that to get that to back to where it should be. So I was been bagging on Jackie the last couple of years. So this year I wanted to give her some kudos. Good job, Jackie. Okay, so if you go to page 43, because you receive approximately $10 million in federal federal awards every on a yearly basis, you're required to have an additional audit, single audit, in accordance with what they call uniform guidance. So this is a more stringent rules to follow because the feds lay them down. But so we're required to opine on that. And we, like I said, if you read these two letters, we did have one finding, but like I said, there was just a minor slip up there, little change in some personnel in the food service, but we got that back straightened out, I think, and we discussed that with Kathy and Bill and Molly, and I think we've got it all figured out. So that's all I really wanted to point out back there. But if you go to page 47 and 48, you can see what your federal dollars are in, Head Start, Early Head Start, et cetera, Title I migrant. I mean, so you've got some very big programs. Of course, food service, I think, is the biggest one. You're almost to $4 million in food service of the $10 million. So, but that gives you a of the different programs that you see on a regular basis and talk about in these meetings. So that's all the big parts that I wanted to hit. I don't know. Do you guys have any questions on any of that? Okay. I believe I gave Bill an engagement letter last November for the deal, and we'll go ahead and file all the reports with the states and the feds. New engagement letter, and basically thank you for allowing us to do the job. We appreciate all the help that we got from HR, Dr. Nance, Bill's office, and the business office. Everybody we deal with here is pretty easy to work with, and we appreciate that. So,
pretty good.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you,
Pat. And sorry you had to wait for an hour and a half before you got.
That's okay. We're on the hour here.
Oh, I'm going to hang around for a little while.
Oh, Lordy. He goes first next year. He goes first.
Moving to the top.
Would you give me a cheaper cost for my audit if you went first?
Yeah.
The Board of Education, by the way, I just might mention, when you look at our normal budget, you kind of got a sense of what we spend just in normal operations. And you add to that what we've done with our bond issue. And I just want to thank publicly my staff, because it's amazing what we've put through the last couple of years. And to get really a clean audit, it's amazing. But the thanks goes to Molly and her team, and I'm very grateful to those. So I just want to publicly thank them this evening, if I may.
Good job to you guys, Bill. Yeah. Nice job.
The Board of Education is respectfully requested to accept the audit report from Kennedy McKee and Company, LLP, Certified Public Accountants for 2017-2018. It is further recommended that the Board renew the contract with Kennedy McKee and Company, LLP, for audit services to be performed in FY 2018-2019, and authorize the Clerk of the Board to sign an engagement letter subject to review by Board Counsel.
Make a motion, we accept the audit report.
Okay.
Second. As presented.
Motion by Jeff, second. Did you second, Ryan? All in favor? 5-0.
Thank you all. Appreciate that. Pat, thank you if you're still here.
He's talking to the attorney. That scares the willies out.
Next item is on the administration building. We basically are breaking that down into several packages this year, because we're trying to move forward as fast as we can, and still takes a little extra time with the shop drawings. So today we're really at proposal two. At this point, we're a little under budget, believe it or not. I don't know it'll stay that way, but we're grateful for that. That's been good news. So the Board of Education is respectfully requested to approve the proposed guaranteed maximum price amendment for package two, structural package, for the new administration building in the amount of $3,277,489 to be paid from capital outlay. The Board is further requested to authorize the Board Clerk to issue a purchase order inside the guaranteed max price amendment subject to review by Board Counsel.
Okay. All right.
One second.
Motion by Pamela, second by Tammy. All in favor? 5-0.
Okay. The next item, and I'm trying to think how to approach this, but as you're aware, 613 has had an office in this administration building for some time, while their main office that is in Zion, Kansas. And anyway, to make a long story short, they have approached us about the possibility of putting their entire operation in our new administration building. And Jeff, if I say anything wrong here, you're going to correct me, because you're on the, you know, down there. But basically, we have about 2,500 square feet that we just plan to pay for. Early on, I talked to Dr. Dirksen. We felt it was important for them to be part of the district. They had been. We really weren't going to ask them anything for what had already been here when we replaced this. We have, however, in the negotiations to put the entire office here, we are negotiating that cost with them at this point. And administration has somewhat recommended, since we had already kind of budgeted in the open space, you know, we're going to, you know, the Board, we basically ended up with a little extra space administration building on the second floor. We can put another 2,500 square feet. We've asked them to potentially pay for the cost of the finish out of that space, and only the finish out. That is pretty good deal, in my opinion, for them. But I think it's, you know, it's a partnership. We're over 60% of the co-op. We pay over 60% of the dues, because that's just our size. That's just who we are today. So that's kind of where we are. I understand they're meeting tomorrow and going to discuss this, so I didn't want to wait any longer to try to get this in front of you. There is a little bit more architectural fees if we finish out that space, because it wasn't part of our original deal. And we're asking for you to approve that tonight, assuming that they approve bringing their entire operation to the administration building. So that's what this is. It's contingent upon them agreeing to move their entire operation in our new administration building.
And they would pay, what did they would pay the finish?
They'd pay the finish. In other words, it's basically open space at this time. Right. In other words, it's shell, what they refer to as a shell space. You know, the walls are there, the windows, some of the HVAC is there, but it's not finished out. And what we're talking about is we've tried to get some pricing. What would it cost to finish that extra 2,500 square feet out? And that's at least what the approach is going to be. We're going to ask them for that. Now, obviously, when we're dealing with a board here and you're dealing with a different board there, I'm not going to say what the final decisions are going to be.
Okay, my question is, we're going to charge them the finish, what it costs to finish it. Are we also going to charge an architectural fee to
The only architectural fee will be for the finish work in that area, yes.
They're part of the architectural fee.
Right.
Do we get a cut on our part of paying for services?
Hasn't been discussed yet, and candidly, I think they're getting a tremendously good deal. I think they're going to have a tremendous, and I say that they're getting a good deal, but it's also going to help our students. They're going to have more opportunities for in-service education because we're going to have meeting rooms there. We're going to have a lot of facilities they just don't really have in their current facility. So I think it's going to be a win-win if we can put this package together. We're going to have to trust our board and Dr. Dirksen as they go forth with that, and we're going to assume we're going to have good news from them.
Will they pay any monthly fee?
We've talked about monthly fees being a portion of the utilities.
Yes.
We've talked about some janitorial fees. Mm-hmm. We already charged them just for, I think, long distance on telephone, some things like that, mm-hmm. and that seems to be acceptable to them.
Okay.
But understand, in all those fees that we assess, we're paying 67% of that fee. So we don't want to get fee crazy. It's ultimately coming back to us.
That's why I think we should get some kind of a cut out of that 67%.
Well, I don't know about that, but I do know that there's a responsibility that we have.
Right.
And I can't predict the future, but I am curious, in 5 to 10 years, what is that percentage going to be?
It was right at.
My guess is it's going up, not down.
Right.
I think it was about 50% when I came here, or a little high, above 50% when I came here 13 years ago.
So.
And the bottom line is, you know, Dodge City has grown. Some of the small towns around us have gone the other direction. You know, I'd like to think that they're going to grow, but that hasn't been the trend for the last number of years. So.
Yeah, I can't. The board.
That's what I feel.
And so it doesn't make sense for them to build a building out in Ensign or
in Dodge City.
Or in Dodge City.
They talked about it as well.
Yeah,
it doesn't make sense because I appreciate the effort that Bill has made and the work that has been done that
right.
I do believe we're presenting almost a hard to refuse offer. That's what right. I think. So,
and it is in our best interest to have it there. There's no doubt in my mind there is, especially.
And I believe it's in the best interest of the 13 school districts of the co-op, because I think it is the best setting. I think it would be the best building. So I might get a little more vocal tomorrow than I was 2 meetings ago. I didn't get to be at the weird meeting. So,
yeah. It was weird.
Okay.
So I'll move for approval.
Yeah.
I second.
All right, we've got a motion by Ryan and a second by Tammy. All in favor? 5-0.
The next item has to do with the City of Dodge City water system. And the City of Dodge City has two water systems, or two water mains, if you will. And we are basically, believe it or not, with some of our schools on the Southern Loop. And the challenge of that is, when you're on the Southern Loop in the northern part of the city, we were okay till we did the reconstruction. But with the reconstruction came new plumbing codes, and we had to put backflow preventers on our main entrances to our building. That cut our water pressure down. That kind of led to the situation we had at Northwest Elementary. As you remember, we had some water mm-hmm. issues and et cetera. And anyway, Dodge City Middle School, we also needed to put a booster pump in Dodge City Middle School. So this is basically to pay for that booster pump. It's a change order number 16 for Dodge City Middle School in the amount of $28,387. But we needed to get the additional water pressure to make sure that all of the quick return urinals and toilets worked, and also operations in the kitchen. So that's the story of this. And if you want a more detailed explanation, I'm going to bring an engineer in, because I'll be honest, I've just told you everything I know and maybe more. So
right. Yeah, that. We don't want another mess.
Yeah.
Make a motion. We approve the whatever Bill said.
Second.
Motion by Jeff and a second by Ryan. All in favor? 5-0.
How soon do you think that can be installed?
It's either been done or it's going to be very close to being done. It's.
I was thinking.
Good thing we voted for it.
Yeah.
I'm glad I approved it.
Good thing.
I asked.
We're just absolutely.
I'd like to change my motion.
How do we get it off?
Oh, Lord.
All right. Next item here. As those of you who were on the board when we started the bond issue, you'll remember that we had the first two or three projects, which were smaller projects in the bond issue, and they came in over budget. And so You didn't have to worry about that because I spent enough time worrying about that over the last couple of years that I did enough worrying for everybody. But at the end of the project, when we've pretty well tabbed up everything, we're going to have a little over 1% of the money left. And that's about $1 million, believe it or not. Now, there are things that we wanted to do with the project, but we, until you got the final numbers in, you finally got all the bids in and everything, we wanted to make sure that we were able to do, one, everything we told the voters, which we have. In fact, we've done more than we told the voters we're going to do. I think that's something that the board can be proud of. But there's a few things that we really felt needed to be done, and I'm going to bring those to you to kind of spend out that money, but we think in ways that are going to enhance the district over the next number of years. For example, one was the security lighting, which you approved the engineering specs on that at the last meeting or previous meeting. Today, we have two things with controls. And if I believed in reincarnation, I want to come back as a control expert because there's got to be money there someplace the way they charge us. But anyway, this is a proposal to upgrade the HVAC building control system at Comanche Middle School. In Comanche Middle School, the control system that was in the old part of the building, the company that produced it no longer exists. It was sold out to another company. That company no longer supports the system that's in the building, which is creating some difficulties and problems. So really the solution of this is to upgrade that, and this is basically for the engineering work so we can put this out to bid and get this taken care of. This is going to be an expensive project, but it should last for a number of years in the future. So the new building and additions at Comanche Middle School are on our train system, but this is the older system that bluntly needs to be replaced. So did I make that? Is there any questions about that?
Has this one already been done too?
No. I just don't know where I know the water pump kind of became a no-brainer because we had to do that and move on. No, this has not been done. This is down the road. There's one here, and then we're going to also talk about one for the high school on this. This is just getting the engineering specs put together so we can put it out to bid.
This one is critical, though, so that we can make good use of our system. So,
I make a motion to approve the proposal to upgrade the HVAC system at Comanche.
Second it. Motion by Jeff, second by Pamela. All in favor?
Okay.
5-0.
Okay. The next HVAC system includes both some controls and some other operations, and this is at Dodge City High School. Basically, there are three rooftop units right now in the CTE building that are not working correctly. To replace the components in those buildings comes close to the cost of a new unit. The recommendation is there are four units in that area, and to bring the crane that we need to bring in, the other one's going to die, just a question of when. So we really recommend that we replace four rooftop units at the CTE building at Dodge City High School. There's also a replacement of a makeup air unit at the CTE building. And then we're adding new units to the existing train control system, and we're upgrading the controls on 9 HVAC units. You approved a contract with ICE to look at energy efficiency, and while we're going to get a report on the current high school thing, is this has been one of the recommendations for several years, that we begin transferring the high school over to the train system because we think we can get better utilization of energy at the high school by doing that. So this is, again, for the engineering. We will bring back after we have engineering, we'll take bids, then it's basically back to the board. So for you know, you'll have the opportunity to approve the actual expenditures.
Are these units we're replacing original to the building?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll make a motion.
Okay, thank you.
I'll second it.
All right, we've got a motion by Tammy and a second by Pamela. All in favor? 5-0.
Thank you. We will be bringing some other items to, like I said, kind of finish out the bond issue money. I think you're going to like what you see. I think it's going to move the district forward in a lot of areas. I appreciate your help this evening, and thank you so much.
Thanks,
hey,
Bill.
I have a question on that.
Okay.
So with the monies that are left, do all the schools have the things they've requested?
I will not say requested. I'll say they have everything that was promised to them in the bond issue. And in most cases, they have more than that than we promised them in the bond issue. We are trying, like with the district exterior lighting, We really wanted to do that while we were doing the bond issue. We just didn't know if we'd have enough money. We're planning to do that at all the schools. So all the schools are going to have adequate exterior lighting. So we're trying to do those kind of things. We were able to do, for example, playgrounds are not included at all the schools on this point. Mm-hmm. We're hoping to be able to go forward, depending on what the, you know, you all direct on capital outlay. The schools that did not get new playgrounds, we're hoping to look at those maybe at least one a year, because that's about $100,000 to $150,000 per playground now. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, there's some things. I went over the list with Chris Myers today at breakfast on the capital outlay. It's $6 to $7 million a request for capital outlay. We probably can't afford, obviously, everything on the list, but we do want to move forward. We had one school that requested, for example, on playgrounds, going back to that, ADA access built into their playground dues and things. We think we probably need to move forward with that request. Paving is parking lots. I could dump, and I don't mean this in a bad word, but we could spend $2 million tomorrow on the high school. We have a lot of paving out there that needs to be replaced. We know that. But there's also other schools who are trying to do some of that each year as we go forward. But there's a lot more requests than there are necessarily dollars available. Yeah. But we're trying to bring everybody up. It's not that we pick and choose. We just try to hit the highest need area.
Trying to prioritize.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. That's kind of where we are. And the capital outlay committee's got to get to have fun doing that this year, because as Dr. Dirksen said earlier, we have radios that have become a priority since I originally kind of thought of the budget this year. You've also directed us to do some work on TEC. That's going to be another budget item. Mm-hmm. You know, and so how does that interplay with other things that we'd like to accomplish? And that's going to be, putting the budget together is going to be interesting this year.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Did I answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, Bill.
Thanks, Bill.
That's a lot of stuff.
Dr. Dirksen?
Okay. I guess I get to ask you if you would be so kind as to extend my contract, as it is written in my contract as I provide.
I'd love to see him grovel.
We do nothing. Actually, I designed the whole board meeting with this in mind, because I did want you to see all the things that are going on within the district.
Yes,
and I do feel like we're moving in a very positive way. I'm very proud of the team that we are putting together and that we have, and I believe that good things are happening. So it would be my honor if you would extend my contract for another year.
And I would like to say that I have dropped the ball on evaluation for Dr. Dirksen.
This is a good time to do this.
And I intended to get it done before you came and asked for us to approve your contract renewal. But I've spoken with Deb this afternoon, and she's going to send those evaluations out to us. I'm not sure when we will be able to go over them, because I don't know about doing a lunch meeting, doing that, and I'll be gone the February 11th meeting, so I'm not sure what we'll do with that evaluation. But
I would like to say that I've been in several different districts and met and worked with and for several different superintendents, and I think Dodge City is quite lucky to have a gentleman that has the knowledge and the expertise and just the general personality to be in this position. I think we're very fortunate to have you, Dr. Dirksen.
It's very nice of you to say. Thank you.
I think we picked a very good choice, and I'm very happy with the work you've done.
Mm-hmm. I guess we'll extend it.
Is that your motion?
Yeah. I'd like to make a motion to extend Dr. Dirksen's two terms. Or 2 years, okay. I would to extend the contract through June 30th of 2020.
I second. We all second. All right. Everybody
can we all second?
A motion by Jeff and a second
pick,
by Tammy, I guess, if she's vice president. All right, all in favor? All right.
Thank you very much.
5-0. Thank you. All right, we have Board of Education member district responsibilities. Park and Rec, Sean, I'm going to put you on the hot seat here because nobody else on this list is here. Is there anything with Park and Rec that we should be aware of?
Not that I'm aware of. We did one at the last meeting, so I'm not discussing that. There's nothing that sticks off the top of my head.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Bright Beginnings and Head Start, Ryan.
We have a meeting tomorrow. So we've got a meeting scheduled for tomorrow at 11:30. We did have a meeting in December. However, we didn't have a quorum. That's very unusual. There's always really good attendance, even the years prior when I was serving on that committee, just variety of different circumstances, but still went through some of the day-to-day business. Betsy gave update on grants, budgeting. Everything's in order, going very well. And then, of course, got updates from Bright Beginnings personnel and staff just related to enrollment and programming, and everything's fine. Everything's going really, really well. So, great. Tammy, do you want to add anything?
No,
I mean,
I think that's, and you guys are submitting grants and working on budgets for next year, so, and really using your community and self-assessments for that kind of planning. So,
yeah.
I think that they're in good spot with that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's accurate. There's one thing that I would like to bring up to the board. With our new construction at Sunnyside, we now have federal interest in our building, and that is turning out to be a big commitment on our part. And that has also changed the way we manage some of the documentation on our grant. We currently use a database called Grant Solutions. And so we are having some challenges acknowledging that part of our responsibility to Head Start. But we're working through those, and there are multiple levels of access and Grant Solutions. And Tammy has the highest, and I have the second highest. And we're working to try to be able to validate that that construction and that federal interest. So that's something we're having a little bit of a problem doing.
And probably just in the sense of not that we can't click validate, when you go in, even though we should have the authority to do that, it's not allowing us to get where we need. And so we've worked with the regional office, we've worked with Grant Solutions specifically, and back and forth. And so, you know, everybody knows we keep trying to log in, but it's not getting us where we need. So we're a process.
Very good. Thank you. Special education.
Meeting tomorrow. And I just been rearranging my appointments, so I'm going.
Okay. Legislative, Pamela, anything you want to?
Well, as of 5 o'clock today, I guess we have a new governor. Governor Laura Kelly has taken over, and she is the first governor in 32 years who's come straight from the legislature. So this should be an interesting governor to have. I also would like to, Mike Hayden was the last one that did that. Kansas Association of School Boards is having their Women in Leadership Conference, and our own Dr. Feist, Jackie, will be there in attendance. I asked her what she will be doing, and she said song, dance, twirling. What else were you going to do?
What is she doing?
Oh, no. I asked for what she was presenting, and go ahead.
I'm presenting at the Women in Leadership Conference, and I didn't know she was sharing that, or I wouldn't know.
With a song and a dance.
No, so we're very pleased to.
Oh, okay.
But it is an honor for our district to have someone who's chosen as a leader in the state. And yeah. I think that's wonderful.
We're very proud of Ms. Feist.
I would like to add on the legislative that Thursday is the Council of Superintendents, also the first day of Tournament of Champions. But because of my position with the new Education Committee, I'm going to the Council of Superintendents because the governor is speaking to that group, and need to be a part of that. What actually Cindy Lane and I are going to meet with the governor afterwards. So that's kind of a neat little event that's taking place on Thursday. So look forward to that. And I think there's still challenges there. We're very grateful to have a governor that is supportive publicly of public education, and I think that means a lot. And then we'll see where it goes from there as far as the whole process.
And you'll be here Friday and Saturday for
business. I will be. Yes.
Kansas politics is going to be interesting the next 4 years.
It is.
It's going to be really interesting.
Well, it's been interesting for
a while. Yeah, but it's going to get really fun here.
True. Capital outlay, is there anything new on
nothing
that?
Nothing yet.
$62 million,
our session on that.
And we
haven't chosen a date yet, but Chris and I reviewed the list today. We'll run out for some more information. Hopefully we'll be meeting pretty quick.
Kansas
politics. There's a lot of things on the list that you don't know, just put that list. Mm-hmm. Right, a little cutting, I think.
Okay. All right. And we heard about the calendar committee where it's in the voting stages right now. Nothing new on the Kansas Heritage Center.
Well, there actually is a lot new on the Kansas Heritage Center that we are, they are moving, and it's farther along than we thought. In fact, they anticipate February.
We anticipate the Kansas Heritage Center will be moved to Dodson Public Library in the month of February.
Okay.
There's been a few hurdles in the way, but we're working through them, and they've been very supportive of providing the help, and our two ladies have done a great job of helping box the materials and that sort of thing. So it's been a team effort.
Very good. And we've got Jeff on the schedule for reviewing the district bills.
Okay.
Before the February board meeting. Also, just a side note, Jeff will be leading the February 11th board meeting. I will not be in attendance. Tammy West will not be able to attend. Pamela may or may not be here physically, but she said she would try to join by phone if possible. So it's very important that we have everybody else here.
Another side note I'd like to ask while we're talking about assignments is we have closed the position for alternative education principal, and I would like a board member to be the board representative for the selection committee. And we haven't set the date yet for what the interviews are, but I would like to know if any of you or do we appoint one of the two that are not here?
I don't mind serving on that if it's
no, that's what I'm asking
prior
for.
To February, are we going to do it?
I honestly don't know what we have set for the. Yeah, okay. That's in the process. So let's start with Pamela, okay? And if we have to schedule after February or whatever, then it needs to be someone else. Who would that somebody else be? Okay, I'm starting with Pamela, and if that doesn't work out, then we'll go with you, okay?
Okay.
All right. So understood.
Okay, very good. We have, of course, coming up 17th, 18th, and 19th of January, the TOC at United Wireless Arena. January 28th, our Board of Education noon meeting at Comanche Middle School. February 11th, Board of Education meeting here at the Austin Boardroom at 6 o'clock. Items for future board meetings and or additional information?
I don't have anything.
Okay. Oh, yes. Wake up, Tammy. Bill, I think I talked to you in December about, I had some questions about the HVAC and the spending with the other companies and ask you to get numbers for me. Okay. To divide out how much is on labor and, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. I had a question.
Anything else? Okay, we need two executive sessions. The first one is for the discussion.
The potential acquisition of property, or real property, and we only need 5 minutes. And then that one will be with our school attorney and Mr. Hammond and I. And then following that, we'll have another executive session that I need for 10 minutes that will be on non-elected personnel. And if Clayton doesn't mind, I'll have him stay for that as well, and we'll have Bill open and close the doors for us as he excuses himself from the first executive session. So 5 and 10.
So I make a motion.
Property and personnel.
So I make a motion for executive session for 5 minutes for property.
I got it.
Thank you, everyone.
I'm taking the over.
Okay. We need a second.
I'll second.
All right. We have a motion by Tammy and a second by Pamela. All in favor?